In my piece about control lines this week, inexplicably, I left out an explanation of how you can control the masks. So this is a little addendum video. Hopefully it's going to be really short, but you never know how these things can work out. And I'm going to be explaining how you control the mask with the opacity control and the chroma and luma sliders. Okay, let's get into it. I thought it would be useful to revisit the problem with this picture before we dive into the tools. So the problem we're trying to correct is uneven lighting in this picture. So this rock here is slightly too dark. This one here, very slightly too dark. That's almost right. This area here is the brightest area on the ground, and that's not really where we want your eye to be drawn with the picture. The sky is some nice detail, a little bit of a lens flare up there, but we can get rid of that later. But the area here suggests if we increase the exposure as a generalized correction, we're going to end up with a very blown out sky here, and that's really not what we want. So we want to try and balance these conflicting things, and we're just going to look at some of the tools, some of the local adjustment tools that will help us do that. The first one we're going to look at is the Grad filter. Now, the Grad filter is the digital equivalent of a piece of smoked glass that you draw down across the lens. It's fairly basic. Let's have a look. So I highlight the Grad filter, I click the plus, and I drag it down from the top across my picture. And if we turn off the black and white mask, we can see much more clearly we can see within the picture much more clearly where that filter is extending to. So this handle here represents the beginning of the graduatedness of the filter, if you like. So if we just wait for that to settle. So from here, we're looking at the top of the picture. Okay, this is the top of the actual frame. If I drag it down further, you can see that the 100% of the filter is applied to the whole of the top of the picture. And this button here controls the orientation, i.e. the tilt. And if you like, the amount or the strength of the gradient. So the more I pull it down, the more gradual that gradient is going to be. But if I pull it all the way down there, you can see that, albeit at 50% or so, the gradient is still right across my rocks and right across my thing. So if I were to darken the sky, my rocks would go black. If I were to lighten the sky so that the rocks are also lit up, then I would blow my sky out. And let's just prove that. So if we take it to that, lighten this up again. Okay, my rocks, more or less okay, two stops advanced. But you can see quite clearly that the sky has lost all its detail. So this is not the answer. Let's get rid of the grad. Let's one more thing to just point out, opacity. If we reduce the opacity of the filter, we can see that that effect is slightly more evened out, but it's still not great, and just reducing the opacity is not really the answer that we're looking for. This isn't going to give me a prize-winning picture. Kill the graduated filter, right? It's great for seascapes. I'll give it that. So let's look at the control line as a possible alternative. Now, the control line is more than just a specialized graduated filter. It's a turbocharged grad filter. There are a lot of bells and whistles on the control line, which we can now demonstrate works in exactly the same way. So we hit the plus, drag it down from the top. Let's just take it down to the horizon. Don't worry too much about that because we're at naught there. Okay, and the first thing to point out is this little dropper. Now I can move that. So if I move that to a dark area, look at the filter. Okay, so what's happening here is that we're sampling the pixels, and the mask is basically going to use pixels that have the same general characteristic. So it's choosing the darker parts of the sky, and these two dark rocks are the where the mask is strongest. Now, this is quite interesting because it means that we can actually have a little bit more control over where these changes are applied. So let's just lighten this up a little bit until the rocks are perhaps slightly more appropriately lit. Round about there. I think we can turn this mask off. Turn the mask off so you can see that the rocks are better exposed. The sky still has detail in it. We can still pretty clearly see this sky here. And miraculously, that lens flare is nowhere near as bad as it was with the other filter. So this is a definite win. This is getting us a lot closer to where we want to be. Now, we can get closer still. So let's turn this mask back on. Let's turn the black and white on so we can see this much more clearly, these changes I'm about to make. Okay, so you can see here in the black and white version, there's a little bit of masking going on there, quite a lot going on there. Let's see how we can influence that by adjusting the Luma. So Luma is luminance. If we turn that up to 100, we can actually have these masks completely focused on the mountain tops. And if we drag that down, you can see that the mask is now covering most of the dark area here. And turning that off for a second, go back to looking at the picture. Oh, let's just fiddle with that exposure again. Okay, so we can see here we've actually got a much better result. This is actually quite good. Let's go back, turn on the masks again. I just want to show you the effects of the control on if we use the Chroma slider. So let's take this back to there. So this was working on luminance, so this was choosing the dark area, right? Now, if we work on Chroma, this is the color, this is going to hit the blues more than anything else. So as we pull that up, now we're still using the dropper to focus there. If we move that into the sky, we should get a completely different effect. Right. And now what we're seeing is we're sampling on the blues and manipulating the Chroma slider allows us to be less sensitive to the chroma-ness, is that even a word? But we're losing the detail here, which is blue-ish. So let's turn that back up. And we'll see that come back, right? So this range of hills here, which is noticeably blue in the photograph, is now coming back under the filter. Turn that up to 100% and you're getting a much more obvious match. Okay, and just to show you that, we'll take the mask off. Lift that exposure a little and you can see that that is now applying to these hills here. We've actually gone slightly too far in this, but let's just show you these effects. So you can see, I hope, as we reduce that, the hills are also getting slightly darker and the more detail is coming back into the sky. Take that the fullest direction, take that into negative territory, and we're now getting a more bluer here, and we've brought back the lens flare there. So you can see that there's potential here. I'll show you a couple of other things that we might think about. If I return this to zero, and I'll just show you this pop-up here. Now, if I invert this mask by Shift and I, give it a second. Okay, close this window down. You're now seeing that this mask is applying to the mountains and the foreground. Now that's interesting, because what that means is we could take up the exposure in the foreground without really affecting the sky. Okay, and that's around the ballpark that we'd be looking to effect. Now, one final thing I'm going to show you with this, and that is, if we put a new control line in and put that here, turn off the black and white mask. I want to see where this is. Okay, now we can pull down that color on the bottom left hand corner. Okay, and now we've got a much better balance. Now, one thing I'll point out, I'm sure somebody there is saying, but what about negative masks? Now, because I had inverted the first mask, I would not be able to apply a negative mask. Now, what a negative mask does is it allows you to effectively erase an area of the mask. So negative masks are achieved by simply clicking on this icon here, and it would be now related to the last mask I drew. So I'll use a pretty exaggerated case for this. So let's draw a new control line from the top. Let's make that a positive one. You have to have a positive line in order to have a negative one. So you've got to have something to change. Let's draw this all the way down across the picture. Okay. So put our masks are on, and let's just put the black and white mask on so we can tune this a little bit. So we're taking the chroma control off. Let's move our pointer down here. Okay, now we're getting the where we want to be. And I think what we want to achieve is to protect this area of the picture from being overly exposed. So when we pull the exposure up, it will come up more here than it will there. So let's add a negative control line in here. Now this is the epitome of an inexact science. So watch the shadow here. Okay. Now we can just adjust that a little bit. Take that back. Perhaps drag this across a little bit over here. Okay, we're beginning to get the idea here. Okay, this is going to be quite rough and ready, but this is not an exact science. So turn off the masks. Turn off the black and white mask. Okay, so you can see from this preview, your mask is now this area, but this area has been completely protected, and this is exactly how it should be. So if we push the exposure up, we should expect to see the area on the right coming up, and the area on the left relatively unaffected. Now, because these are graduated filters, we're not seeing this at 100%. The masks are not 100%. The masks are graduated, so it's kind of subtle. If we take it down, you'll notice that the area here is protected. It's not being radically changed, unlike the sky. Take it back up again. Okay, same thing. Area on the left protected, area on the right is being altered. All right, so that concludes the options on control lines. So thanks for bearing with us. If you'd like to take a second to subscribe or like the video, that would be massively appreciated. And we'll see you in the next video. Thanks a lot. Bye.